Hello, and welcome to the Trader Course with Forex.com. This is a six-part series designed to walk you through some of the most pertinent subject matter on the Forex market. This curriculum was created by James Stanley, and he will be here momentarily to introduce the course, after which he will walk you through today's discussion on fundamental analysis. We must first look at a disclaimer for 60 seconds, after which James will be on the line to welcome you to the Trader's Course. Thank you for your time in advance, and happy trading.
Hello, my name is James Stanley and welcome to the Trader Course. The design of this curriculum is to provide a broad base of education for Forex traders. But really, there may be applicability on many of these topics to other markets, as no market in the world is predictable, and that's the approach that we're going to take with this content. What that means, we're going to take a pragmatic approach towards teaching you market dynamics. We're not going to pretend that there's some holy grail strategy that's always going to win, that can allow a trader to just pick winning setups without having to learn the importance of risk or trade management. No, the future will always retain a degree of uncertainty. And while analysis can help a trader to align probabilities, at no point will it ever be truly predictive. There is always the opportunity for error. This means that traders should learn risk management, because as long as there's the risk that just one or two bad trades can wipe away the gain from numerous winners, finding consistent success can prove as a significant challenge. There are no holy grails in trading, at least in my opinion, so I'm not going to teach you otherwise. We are all operating from imperfect information in markets, and there is always a degree of projection when setting up trades with the aim of making a profit. In most ventures in life, the frequency of wins is important. Like in sports, if you ask how a team is doing, the common answer will be their win-loss record, or perhaps a winning percentage. This denotes how often they were successful. In trading, win rate can be important, but the size of wins and the size of losses is also important, because the goal, at the end of the day, is usually to make money. And if you can find one trade that produces enough profit to offset the loss of four losing trades, well, that means the trader could be profitable even if only winning 20% of the time. It may not feel good facing failure 80% of the time, but again, if the goal is to make money, then winning percentage itself could be a less important variable. Risk and psychology. These are two items that are usually somewhat in your control. You will never control how price will perform, and you'll probably never be the spark point for a new trend. In many cases, a trader is merely riding the wave of market cycles, but they have control over their risk management, and they can attempt to impact their own psychology. And between those two variables, traders can have points of optimization that can help them to continue to build out their approach. This course will be actionable, as in we're going to focus on those more controllable factors, and we're going to teach the basics of both fundamental and technical analysis, along with trading strategy and price action, so that you can form your own approach, your own strategy, your own trading plan. The aim of this course is to walk you to the door and to try to give you an outline of the room that you're walking into with global markets. But this is a self-directed course, so I urge you to take notes, make this content your own, and build your own approach on the basis of what you think would be the best fit for your bespoke approach towards navigating markets. I'm here to help, and I'll provide as much support as I can through this venue. Lastly, we have an incredibly broad base of content here. I've designed this as a 6-part series, which we'll talk about in a moment, but each installment addresses a wide field that could allow for years of self-study. Fundamental analysis, for instance, is related to studying economics, and there are many that go through PhD programs in this field. Technical analysis has its own crowd, as does price action. The aim here is to expose you to a wide breadth of content so that you can best orient yourself with how you want to approach the market. Now, let's look at how we're going to do this. I had mentioned a broad base of education a moment ago, so let's discuss which topics are going to be covered in this course. The first topic, which we will discuss today, is fundamental analysis. And while we are doing an introduction here, I think it's key for a self-directed course to illustrate the importance of taking action. So we're getting started today. As a matter of fact, after this next slide, we will dive right into that topic. Our next section is on technical analysis with a very broad base. And this complements the first lesson on fundamental analysis quite well. Fundamental analysis is often focusing on inputs in effort of producing a forecast. So for an individual company, this is like following cash flows, market share, new products, in effort of forecasting how that company might perform amidst that specific backdrop. This is relevant in Forex as well, with focus on items like employment or inflation, in effort of forecasting how the central bank might react or respond. And that's an effort of forecasting how prices might perform. Technical analysis, on the other hand, is a bit more direct in that it focuses directly on price, but by definition, those are past prices. So we can say that technical analysis is more concerned with the past, as it's the study of the price chart that simply illustrates recent pricing behavior in the market. Now, we all know the past does not predict the future. From the vantage point of the technical analyst, if history doesn't repeat, it may rhyme, and observations from the chart could lead into potential trade ideas. Trends usually take place for a reason, often something that could be tied back to fundamentals. Support and resistance can help to show relative high or low points or prices given recent history. Support and resistance can also be helpful for risk management, as a trader looking to buy might not want to hold on for much longer if prices in that market are dropping through support. So the application of technical analysis here could have a similarly wide base, but in reality, both technical and fundamental analysis can complement each other quite well. Price action is a specific study of technical analysis that involves analyzing a chart without any indicators at all. This is commonly looked at as an intermediate to advanced field of study, but the application for risk management here can be important. So we're going to address this topic in our third section for price action. Strategy is pretty important in trading. It allows for some element of uniformity, which can allow the trader to take an apples-to-apples approach towards markets in order to allow them to focus on the most important thing, success. The reason that strategy is so important to a trader is the opportunity for improvement. In most ventures of life, we're probably not going to be very good when we get started. But as we gain experience and learn more about what it is that we're doing, we have more tools at our disposal to aim towards that goal. Without a strategy, the trader is essentially waking up in a new world every morning, where they have to recreate the wheel in order to come up with trade ideas. The strategy can be simple, or it can be complex, but it's your tool for finding adequate setups in the market, whatever that might mean to you. And it's a tool that can be optimized and improved upon as more feedback or results come in. Risk management. I've already touched on this a couple of times, but the importance of this cannot be understated. Regardless of how great of an analyst you ever become, there's always going to be a degree of uncertainty. But we're human, so this is not something that's uncommon, as every other human being also lacks that future-telling capability. What is more controllable is how much risk you're going to take with each individual trade, or how much leverage you're going to use, or what size of targets or rewards you're going to look for in comparison to the risk that's being taken on. Risk management will not help you to predict the future, But that's not the point. The point is to mitigate the damage from when you are inevitably wrong, while allowing for the maximization of benefit when you're right. I'm not going to pretend that this is simple, because as human beings, we want to win. And it's difficult to get in a position where you're not trying to win every single trade. But it does bring up the importance of losing the battle in order to win the war. But really, that speaks to a larger concern, and this is something that you will deal with throughout your trading career, and that's your own psychology. People like to win, and that feels good. And they usually dislike losing, because that feels bad. And if there's a financial component behind it, those emotional swings can be quickly exacerbated, as the fear or pain of losing also comes along with losing money. The best way to approach this topic is head-on, in my opinion, with planning and trying to be proactive. This will not prevent emotions. That will be ever present. But it can provide a roadmap that can allow you to stay on course by simply diagramming a plan of actions that you want to consistently take. It may feel bad at times, but it can feel good too. The key is staying on your track, and this is something that probably every person on earth deals with in some way or another, in trying to harness their own personal discipline. In this section, I will give you a logical plan of attack to attempt to address this right up front. Just one more slide before we get to fundamental analysis, but I want this course to be considered as a risk-first type of curriculum. So let's look at what we ultimately want to avoid. The dreaded catastrophic loss. This is why risk management is so important, even if you become an amazing analyst with a high win rate. Unfortunately, this is something that many traders don't learn until it's too late. But the general premise is, once you lose money, it's gone. And making it back will be that much more difficult because you'll be starting with a lower capital base. Let's explain by looking at the top row. And let's assume that you open an account with $10,000. And then you lose 10% on your first trade. That's a loss of $1,000, leaving you with a $9,000 equity balance. If you want to get back to $10,000, a 10% return will not do it, because 10% of $9,000 is only $900. So you would be at a total of $9,900, denoting a 1% overall loss. If you want to get back to the original $10,000, you're going to need to make an 11.11% return to offset that initial 10% loss. This is trader math. Once you lose money, it's gone. And to get back to where you were is going to require more and more effort. This can be a slippery slope. If the same trader risked another 10% on a second trade and lost again, taking their account down to $8,000, well, then they would need a 25% return just to get back to their original $10,000 starting balance. If losing 30%, now they need to make back 42.86%. If losing 40%, now they need to hit 66.67% just to get back to the original $10,000 starting balance. And if they go down to a 50% loss, well, now they need to double their account or get a 100% return just to get back to where they had started. Now this slope keeps slipping, and I could keep reading off these values all day, but the point here isn't to scare you. It's to highlight the importance of trying to mitigate losses. This is the scenario that you absolutely want to avoid, because it's the same type of scenario that can wreak havoc on your own psychology. Imagine making an 80% return but still being underwater. And every day when you open your platform, that net loss is still looking you in the face, even if you just had massive success of an 80% return. This speaks to why psychology is so incredibly important, because generally speaking, people try to avoid pain. And in this scenario, with enough time, the trader is going to face a number of challenges that could compel them to look elsewhere with their time. In reality, this is something that can be addressed up front. Now, it doesn't ensure that you won't end up in a drawdown, nor does it guarantee that you will avoid taking losses. But you can take the most logical manner of approach in order to mitigate the potential for such a scenario. And this is why risk management is so important. Analysis is important too, as this is what can help a trader to find ideas that might work in effort of devising a strategy or approach that's repeatable based on that trader's specific personality and preference. With that said, let's dive into fundamental analysis. Fundamental analysis is a wide field of study that involves looking at the inputs of an economy in effort of forecasting how that economy might perform in the future. Many economics majors in college or master's programs study this type of data, and this is what central banks are usually following in effort of setting monetary policy. So the field of study in this area of the market can be extensive depending on how deeply one wants to incorporate it. Employment is a major aspect of fundamental analysis, and this is a significant data point to follow. The rationale is fairly clear. The more people that are working, the greater the potential for economic growth. This information is disseminated in U.S. markets via the non-farm payrolls report that comes out every month and initial jobless claims data, which comes out weekly. These reports can entail significant volatility, particularly the NFP report, as it's an early look at the most recently completed month of economic activity. The implication from employment is that stronger growth in jobs may lead to stronger overall economic growth. And this may be something that compels the central bank to look towards tighter monetary policy if those trends persist, as central bankers can worry of an overheating economy. But if employment numbers are bad and job growth is slow, that's also a concern for the central bank. And this may push them towards loosening policy in effort of stoking economic growth while also bringing on a possible rise in inflation. Which brings us to our next topic, inflation. Inflation is a massive point of interest for central banks, as this is the primary mandate for central banks in Europe and Japan. If prices are gyrating wildly, consumer behaviors can change. This can lead to hoarding behaviors and a general sense of panic in the actual economy. This can have knock-on effects too, as producers rush to make more product to meet enhanced demand as produced by the panic of rising prices. That can then lead to a glut of inventory when the market inevitably settles. Ideally, inflation is somewhat stable, so that consumers can focus on consuming, and this is generally what central banks are attempting to do with inflation targeting. And inflation data could be a large market mover on the basis of implications that it may entail from the representative central bank. Interest rates are a major driver, as this is the mechanism between the central bank and the market. Central banks often set short-term rates, with longer-term rates determined by markets and the dynamics in those markets via the actions of market participants. This can deliver a significant message to the central bank. Interest rates play a large role in the economy, as this is what the central bank uses to prod growth or to try to temper inflation. But in reality, it's largely a transmission mechanism because it's market participants, not central banks, that are setting longer-term interest rates. And this is important. Central banks are important, and this has become increasingly important in the backdrop from the global financial collapse. Actions from the central bank can create significant reverberations throughout markets, whether it's a rate cut or an announcement of quantitative easing, or perhaps the opposite, with rate hikes and quantitative tightening. The central bank plays a large role in the economy, and their actions can have massive consequences. So market participants will often follow this very closely, and these dynamics can carry significant impact. This can be something as casual as a comment on television, perceived to be dovish or hawkish from an individual central banker, at which point markets will then hurriedly try to price that information in. But let's begin the discussion on fundamental analysis from a place that we're all at least somewhat familiar with, interest rates.
Interest rates play a large role in the economy for both central banks and market participants. And, of course, interest rates have large implications across the economy, as lower interest rates can spur economic activity, while higher rates may be used by a central bank that's trying to stem inflation. But let's begin the conversation from the ground floor and work our way up to central bank policy and macroeconomic ramifications.
Interest rates have a direct impact on Forex markets. And one way to see that is with the rollover or swap amount of a currency pair. This is the daily interest that's paid or earned based on the interest rate divergence between the currencies represented in the pair. You can see a historical snapshot of this data on the right side of the screen, taken from March 16th of 2023, when this was created. If one economy is lifting interest rates while the other is not, that can increase the swap or rollover paid for holding that currency pair. And as the interest payment increases on that side of the pair, this can drive additional demand to the higher yielding currency to get the new higher rate of return. As you can imagine, that additional demand can tilt prices in that market higher and possibly even help to create a bullish trend. This leads into a widely followed strategy known as the carry trade that we'll begin to discuss on the next slide. As noted a little earlier, the Federal Reserve sets short-term interest rates, and this is what we'll hear about during FOMC rate decisions when the bank is making adjustments to interest rates on the basis of economic data and performance. This is known as the Fed funds rate, and this is the rate that the bank will adjust when they want to impact the economy by either slowing or hastening economic activity. U.S. Treasury rates are highly important in the market, but these rates are determined by market activity. Treasury rates can often track short-term rates, but this is not always the case, because again, Treasury rates are determined by market participants. If market participants anticipate that rates may move down in the future, or if they have a bearish view on the economy with the expectation that the Fed will have to soften policy by cutting rates, they can then buy longer-term treasuries with the aim of capturing the higher rate before rates go down. And because bond prices and yields move inversely, the very act of interest rates moving down in the future can make the principal portion of that bond worth more. And the investor who bought it when rates were higher may be able to sell the bond at a profit, as the new lower rate regime would pay a premium for that bond yielding an above market rate. You may have heard of yield curve inversion, and that's what this refers to, when longer term US rates go below shorter term US rates. And this is an example of how Treasury rates are determined by market participants and not the Federal Reserve. Fundamental data such as employment and inflation will have an impact on rates as market participants price that data in. This can similarly impact FX pairs, as the prospect of higher rates can lead to greater demand as investors factor in that higher probability of increased rates. Rollover or swap is the interest that's paid or earned at 5 p.m. Eastern time based on the Forex pair that you're holding long or short. And again, on the right side of the screen, you'll see an example of the rollover table from Forex.com. This is a screenshot that was taken on March 16th, 2023. These rates do change daily, and this is based on short-term rates in the marketplace that are often moving in response to central bank moves or expectations. With a Forex pair, since two economies are represented, the rollover or swap amount is based on the divergence in interest rates between those two economies. And if one economy is increasing interest rates while the other isn't, well, that can help to drive demand to the side of the pair represented by higher rates. And again, we'll touch on an example on the next slide. You can follow along these rates as they change. This web address will show these rates on a daily basis as they adjust. To investigate the carry trade, we're going to look at an example of what increasing interest rates can do in a market with a recent illustration using dollar yen. When the COVID pandemic came into the equation in Q1 of 2020, the Federal Reserve acted quickly to provide stimulus to American markets with the hope of softening the inevitable economic blow from wide-scale shutdowns. This stimulus involved numerous liquidity injections, and by the time we got to the 2021 open, equity markets had found support, and in many cases had recovered the entirety of their pandemic-fueled losses. As a case in point, the S&P 500 hit a fresh all-time high in January of 2021, and this is emblematic of that heavy-handed stimulus approach from both monetary and fiscal policy. But in 2021, inflation started to grow. The Federal Reserve was worried that removing the stimulus that had helped markets to recover might derail the recovery. So they continued to watch inflation climb, driven by the presumption that inflation was transitory and resultant from supply chain disruptions taking place around the pandemic. Despite that, markets did start to price in greater USD strength, as you could see in the red box through the first 9 months of 2021. The data or inflation was increasing, but the transmission mechanism around that, the expectation around the central bank in relation to that data, wasn't keeping pace, as the Fed was saying that they thought higher levels of inflation were transitory. Nonetheless, markets were pricing in a greater probability of an eventual rate hike on the basis of that inflation data and the continued recovery in the U.S. economy. It was late 2021 when the Federal Reserve began to open the door to possible rate hikes to stem that inflation. And this was first expressed formally from the bank at the December 2021 rate decision, when the FOMC first began to forecast rate hikes for the U.S. economy in 2022. As the prospect of higher rates started to get priced into markets, capital flows began to drive into the USD in anticipation of that eventual higher rate of return. And meanwhile, the Bank of Japan was indicating little to no possibility of any near-term hikes, thereby allowing for the divergence in dollar-yen to grow and grow and grow. This created increasing divergence in rates between the two economies and thusly led to a trend in the currency pair, as higher U.S. rates were getting priced in alongside Japanese rates that were expected to remain low. And in the yellow box, as the Fed started to prepare the market for rate hikes in 2022, we could see the trend in dollar-yen really lifting off. This is the carry trade, where higher rates can drive capital flows into a pair, which can allow for principal gains as more traders follow a similar line of thinking of buying the higher yielding currency while selling the lower yielding currency. You've just had a very basic introduction to trading strategy, and this is a common fundamental strategy that involves focusing on movements or shifts in interest rates in effort of deducing trends in the FX market. This is a more granular look at the illustration from our last example, and the point here is to highlight the incredibly important role of expectations. It may not be rates themselves that are doing all of the push, but rather the expectation for what rates may do in the future. Now, as noted on our previous slide, the bullish trend in dollar-yen began in 2021, before the Federal Reserve ever mentioned the prospect of rate hikes. We could see prices in dollar-yen climbing over the 200-day moving average here in the red circle in Q1 of that year. This indicator will be discussed in greater depth in our technical analysis section, but for now, we merely want to point out that it's often used to diagnose trends on a longer-term, bigger-picture basis. Price then retained a generally bullish lean as dollar-yen remained above the 200-day moving average for the rest of 2021 trade. And towards the end of the year, the Federal Reserve finally starts to signal the possibility of rate hikes in 2022, an effort of addressing the inflation that had continued to grow throughout the year. Markets have been pricing in that theme to a degree, as noted by the bullish movement in the pair, despite the fact that rates were not being raised. But once there was greater clarification that rate hikes may happen, markets started to price that in as well. Once we got into 2022, that generally bullish bias remained, and this is evidence of the market pricing in greater odds of more rate hikes from the FOMC. The Fed hiked rates for the first time since 2018 in March of 2022, and at that point, they warned that more rate hikes may be on the way as they continued to address inflation. we can see that bullish trend taking on a whole new level of aggression as buyers hurried into the pair, not only because of the rate hike, but also the guidance provided by the Fed that more rate hikes were on the way. This trend continued to run for the first 10 months of 2022 trade, and when all was said and done, dollar yen had gained as much as 48.1% from the 2021 low up to the 2022 high. And this is a non-levered currency pair, which makes the size of that move all the more interesting. But again, this is about the role of expectations. And something happened in that red box that created a fast and heavy reversal in the dollar yen currency pair. In September of 2022, hope was rising that the U.S. may have already seen peak inflation. Along with that came the expectation for possibly a softer touch from the Fed in the coming months. But also of issue was yen weakness, which had just lost 48.1% of its value to the U.S. dollar over the prior 21 months, from the 2021 open to the 2022 high. And this led to thoughts that perhaps the Bank of Japan could possibly shift policy. This combined effect of a possibly weaker USD and a possibly stronger Japanese yen created a pullback, but the pullback didn't stop, as more and more investors who had bought on the way up now had to consider whether they wanted to stay in the trade. As price fell further, the motivation for longs to close also increased. And over the next 3 months, the dollar-yen pair fell by as much as 16.27%. During this time, the Fed continued to hike by 75 basis points in November of 2022 and 50 basis points a month later. The Bank of Japan showed no signs of possible tightening, which means that the fundamental bias that existed previously, as illustrated by rate divergence, still existed. But the price movement was clearly different, and again, this illustrates the value of expectations. This continued FOMC rate hikes and Bank of Japan showing little willingness for change seemed to matter little, as markets were trying to look around the next corner. Once we actually got into the year of 2023, the Fed continued to hike, albeit at a slower pace than before, with 25 basis point hikes in January and March. And again, the Bank of Japan showed little tolerance for tighter policy. As such, we could see an 8.4% gain from the January low up to the March high, which is, again, illustrative of expectations, more so than actual rate policy.
Central banks play a vital role in markets as they are charged with managing monetary policy to steward the economy towards the goal of healthy, sustainable economic growth. In more recent years, the role of the central bank has expanded with many developed central banks embarking on quantitative easing programs, which entails significant activity in an economy's bond markets. Let's learn more about how central banks engage with markets.
Central banks have an important role in today's economy as they set policy, which then drives economic behavior. Monetary policy is designed to be economic policy with a relatively short half-life, while fiscal policy is designed to have a longer-term impact, and that's usually determined by the governing body. In the United States, that's Congress. With quantitative easing taking on more and more importance since the financial collapse, the role of central banks has seemed to expand as well, as banks aren't just setting interest rates when embarking on QE. And this is one of the reasons that central bank activity is so carefully tracked. But the primary focus for most central banks is setting of short-term rates. They'll usually do this regarding rates of inflation, as many central banks have a target rate for inflation at 2%. This is what the Federal Reserve, the European Central Bank, and the Bank of Japan all strive for. If there's too much inflation, then consumers can quickly get frightened, and this can impact economic behavior, which can then create other reverberations in the economy. Too little inflation, however, may be a sign of lacking growth, and this is often where the central bank will look to cut rates in effort of stoking economic activity. Many central banks are called single mandate central banks, which mean their primary focus is on controlling inflation. The Fed is an outlier in this regard, as they're considered a dual mandate central bank, which means that they're also charged with focusing on and molding policy to employment, as well as inflation. This means that they'll set policy with consideration of both data points, which can mean even more motivation to stoke growth if inflation is low and unemployment numbers are higher than they would like to see. We'll talk about this in more depth on our next slide. Central banks and their members are closely tracked for clues or hints towards future policy announcements. Even something as simple as a comment during a television interview can tilt market expectations, and this could bring on large impacts to short-term price action. As rate expectations shift, so can prices in a number of markets, ranging from Forex to stocks to commodities. As noted a moment ago, most central banks have the responsibility of managing inflation, and a 2% inflation target is common for many developed central banks, like the Federal Reserve, the European Central Bank, or the Bank of Japan. If inflation is too high, the bank will usually look to increase interest rates. The logic here is that the higher interest rate may attract capital into markets to capture that new higher rate of return. Think of this from the perspective of a bond investment through your local bank. Perhaps a 3% rate isn't attractive, but 5% might be. So as rates go up, investors can be incentivized to invest, and that pulls money from the money supply in order to invest in the new higher rate of return. And as there's less capital in the money supply, or said otherwise, as the money supply tightens, this can slow economic activity. On the flip side, if inflation is low, that can be a sign of slow or non-existent growth, and this can be concerning to a central bank. In that case, the bank will often look to cut interest rates. And as rates go down, there's less incentive for investors to invest their capital in rate-bearing investments. And deductively, this means more capital that can be deployed in the economy. This can be to invest in small businesses, or to spend, or any other economic driver away from those interest-bearing investments. This is called looser monetary policy, and this is designed to stoke economic growth in the economy. As we mentioned a moment ago, a dual mandate central bank, such as the Fed, will also incorporate employment data into their decisions, and this makes policy setting seem a bit less objective, as there's not a singular data point that the bank is responsible for, and more of a stewarding of the economy through these two different but important data points. This explains the Fed stance in 2021, when they let inflation run above target for an extended period of time. One of the main reasons cited was the labor market. Most central banks want to ensure growth in the economy. So even for a single mandate central bank, they're not usually looking to eliminate inflation as much as they're looking to keep it in a relatively consistent low level so that consumers can consume. They want to ensure that they're not damaging the labor market by hiking too much, as this can hinder growth and eventually lead to less economic activity. As such, GDP data can be important for central banks, although this is a lagging data point, so it may not be as impactful as their direct mandates of inflation and possibly even employment. This is an important concept, and within the field of fundamental analysis, it's probably one of the more critical concepts to understand with price dynamics. So I wanted to be sure to recap this in a formulaic manner. Inflation is often seen as a byproduct of economic growth. And after a strong period of growth and higher prices, the central bank is also usually looking at lower rates of unemployment and more competition for workers. And supply and demand can work with workers' wages in the same manner as price dynamics in a market, where greater demand for workers leads to higher wages to attract those workers, and this can further feed into the inflationary cycle. If inflation is too high, the central bank will usually be concerned of inflation getting out of hand, because as prices begin to increase and employers have to increase wages to attract workers, this can lead to a price spiral as prices continue to increase, and eventually the central bank may lose control. This is what central banks absolutely want to avoid. So generally, they're looking to moderate inflation, and in the US, this is at the 2% target. But when inflation does climb above that, it starts to become a concern for the bank, and at that point, they'll often look to increase interest rates. The rationale being that higher rates then attract capital. And as capital is attracted into interest-bearing investments to capture those new higher rates of return, capital is leaving the money supply. This is policy tightening from the central bank, as driven by higher rates and rate hikes. And when you hear of a rate hike, you'll often hear of that bank tightening monetary policy. And that's what this refers to. That economic theme is usually taking place after robust economic activity. And for the part of the central bank, they're generally looking to slow the economy in order to allow for greater long-term sustainable growth. On the other hand, if inflation is too low, this can also be a concern for the central bank, as it may be a sign of lacking growth. And economic growth is important for an economy as it allows for greater employment, higher wages, and a general aim of economic progression as new technologies are produced to create greater efficiencies. If inflation is considered to be too low, the central bank will often look at looser monetary policy, and this will usually entail rate cuts and generally low rates. This makes interest-bearing investments less attractive, and this gives investors reason to employ their capital elsewhere, as there's less opportunity cost in long-term bonds, as denoted by the lower rate regime. This can drive capital into other areas of the economy, including incentivization for consumers to make long-term purchases of durable goods, as the lower rates make the cost of financing an automobile, or perhaps even a home, a more attractive prospect. The low rate backdrop will generally be a benefit for higher growth initiatives, as there's less opportunity cost from market-based interest-bearing investments. The aim here isn't necessarily to produce inflation, but more towards the goal of creating greater growth. But since inflation is often seen as a byproduct of growth, and growth itself could be a difficult driver for a central bank who's largely focused on monetary policy as opposed to fiscal policy, low rates can help to create that backdrop that can be more conducive to greater growth trajectories. Central bank rate decisions are key dates for traders to keep in mind. These are predetermined dates throughout the year at which the central bank meets to decide on rate policy. This is usually where any policy changes that the central bank wants to impose will be announced. And given the fact that this is new information that's coming into the market, these events can create significant volatility and perhaps can even create the spark of a fresh new trend. The Federal Reserve hosts 8 rate decisions per year, and every other meeting is considered to be a quarterly rate decision, which means that the Fed will also issue updated projections and guidance. And those, similarly, can produce significant volatility, as this is the way that the bank will disseminate their own expectations. Central bank members will consider the overall body of data, with central banks in Europe or Japan focusing solely on inflation, while a dual mandate central bank like the Federal Reserve will also focus on employment. At the conclusion of the bank's meeting, there will usually be an announcement accompanied by the statement, which is often followed by a press conference with the head of the central bank explaining the context around their decision. This can similarly create significant volatility throughout the press conference, as there are numerous opportunities for the head of the central bank to drive new information into the market. The traders and market participants then need to price in. This can also create sharp reversals or, again, spark new trends as the market absorbs this information. Rate decisions can be difficult time for traders to try to establish new positions because of this additional volatility. Most central banks communicate with the public through their own websites. And this is a list of some of the larger central banks. These websites will usually receive the bank's statement for a rate decision as soon as it's released, and will also contain a plethora of additional information. Each bank has their own nuance around rate decisions, and if trading around news events, it's worthwhile to become familiar with how that bank operates before taking on any significant risk because, again, rate decisions can be large drivers of volatility. On this screen, we're seeing six of the largest national central banks along with their official websites. Each of these banks monitor and focus on managing inflation via monetary policy. But the data points that they follow can create significant volatility on their own. Let's take a closer look at inflation.
Inflation is defined as the rate of increase in prices over a given period of time. Inflation is typically a broad measure, looking at the overall increase in prices or the increase of cost of living in an economy. Inflation can bring large repercussions to the economy, so generally speaking, central banks strive for stability with inflation. Let's learn more on the topic.
Inflation can be qualified as a general increase in prices and a fall in the purchasing value of money. As an example, if a soda costs $1 today and your income is $100,000 per year, well, you could buy 100,000 sodas per year if you didn't pay any taxes and you spent all of your money on carbonated beverages. But if the price increases to $1.10 next year and your income does not move up accordingly, then you won't be able to buy as much soda. At $1.10 per soda and $100,000 to spend, instead of 100,000 sodas, you would only be able to buy 90,909.09 sodas. The inflation rate of 10% would mean that you can buy 10% less soda next year if your income did not move up accordingly. As you can imagine, such a fast change can spark some interesting changes with consumers. With the price of soda rising rapidly, this can lead to stockpiling or panic buying. And as consumers bought more and more soda to try to offset future price increases, this would mean less supply of soda in the marketplace, which could mean even more price increases as the demand for soda, even at higher prices, now has no supply. This can create panic in an economy if it's broad-based, and this is generally something that central banks want to avoid. They often want to do this with inflation targeting. And this is a quote taken directly from the Reserve Bank of Australia's website, where they say, "The Reserve Bank uses an inflation target to help achieve its goals of price stability, full employment, and prosperity and welfare of the Australian people." This is because price stability, which means low and stable inflation, contributes to sustainable economic growth. So when inflation runs higher, above target, the bank will often look to tighten policy by lifting interest rates and attracting capital out of the money supply. Or, if inflation runs below target, they'll look to cut interest rates to spur economic activity by incentivizing capital to go back into the money supply with lower rates and lower opportunity cost of being invested in rates-bearing investments. Measuring inflation presents a number of challenges, namely, in making an apples-to-apples comparison of economic activity between periods. This does mean that inflation measuring will often be imperfect because other items in the economy are changing, and a good example of that is the television. Entry-level TVs used to cost quite a bit, and this was a big factor in CPI reports. But as technology has further developed, and televisions have gotten generally cheaper, this is now less of a factor for high inflation in CPI reports today. This means that comparing a CPI print from 40 years ago to today is really looking at a different economic environment. As touched on at the beginning of this section, the consumer price index is a major focal point for inflation. On the right side of this slide, you could see the components that are measured in this report. This is issued from the BLS, or the Bureau of Labor Statistics in the United States, and these reports are available on their website on the date of release each month. But this isn't the only data point that attempts to measure inflation. The Producer Price Index attempts to measure price changes from the perspective of the seller, which contrasts with CPI, which is seen from the vantage point of the consumer. This data point attempts to measure wholesale inflation, which may then feed down to CPI. So this is an attempt at the market to take a leading look at what may impact consumer prices in the future. The big question is whether producers will pass on those higher levels of inflation or whether they'll attempt to absorb those price increases by allowing their margins to get squeezed. There are other measures of inflation for consumers, and the Personal Consumption Expenditures Index, or PCE, is an example of that. This is issued from a different agency, the Bureau of Economic Analysis, or BEA, and it's also issued on a monthly basis. Of interest for this discussion is the volatility that can emanate from these announcements. The actual release of these data points can be very volatile periods in markets as something new is getting priced in. And this can lead to a fast shuffling as market makers, banks, and liquidity providers all look to react to this new data. CPI, PPI, and PCE are all released at 8:30 a.m. Eastern Time, an hour before U.S. equity markets open for the day. As we move towards that 8:30 release, there can be a tendency for liquidity to move lower as market makers brace for this new information, and lower liquidity can further feed into higher levels of volatility. In the image on the right side of this slide, you could see one CPI release in Eurodollar in March of 2023. The currency pair put in a 50 pip range over 2 minutes after this data was released. And for most of the hour and a half after, prices continued to work within this range. This is the process of price discovery. And in this case, the market still hadn't picked a discernible direction for more than an hour after that release. Perhaps more importantly, the response to data can be counterintuitive, where data that should spell higher prices actually brings on the opposite initially. And the reason that this can happen is the value of expectations. This opens the dreaded scenario where even if you predicted the data print perfectly as it came out, you could still end up losing on a trade if the market does something different than you expect. As a trader, it's the market reaction and price that could trigger stops or cause margin calls. The data point that may drive the market is just a part of what could be. For data, generally speaking, a longer term could bring on more of a logical relationship, as we'll investigate on the next slide. We're going to draw back to our dollar-yen example in effort of illustrating inflation impact on FX markets. And again, we're going to look at the dollar-yen currency pair from the 2021 open through March 20th of 2023. I've plotted the CPI rate on the date of each release, and in the middle of the chart, I've noted the Fed's first rate hike of that cycle in March of 2022. This is denoted with the royal blue line with the label of 25 BPS on top. BPS stands for basis points, or also called BIPs. Coming into the year, CPI was below the Fed's 2% target, coming in at 1.4%. The same printed in February, but in March, inflation has started to move higher, up to 1.7%. In April, CPI crossed the 2% marker, and in May, above 4%. In June, CPI touched 5%, and noticed that the dollar-yen pair at that point had gained since the 2021 open, as those rates of inflation continued to move higher. At the time, the Federal Reserve continued to downplay the prospect of rate hikes, saying that inflation was due to supply chain issues and was likely transitory. They were hesitant to hike, as they said that they wanted to see continued strength in the labor market. Inflation continued to climb, however, and it wasn't until late November 2021, at Jerome Powell's renomination hearing in front of Congress, that we started to see that change. I've indicated this with a red line on the chart. This was the point where Powell first mentioned the notion of retiring the word transitory in regards to inflation. This was largely read by markets to mean that the bank may be more open to raising rates to address those higher levels of inflation. Notice that the dollar-yen pair trended higher through much of this period, but it was not lockstep, as there were periods where the pair's price moved down after a strong inflation print, which indicates, while inflation may have a role on longer-term price action, the impact on shorter-term price action isn't always a direct relationship. But let's look deeper into this example. I wanted to focus in on what was happening before the Federal Reserve started to talk about rate hikes. This is of interest because traders that were looking for a direct response in the dollar-yen currency pair to higher levels of inflation in 2021 may have been disappointed on more than one occasion, as there were multiple periods where higher levels of inflation did not lead to higher spot rates in the dollar and currency pair. If we look at the move with more scope, there was a bullish move in early 2021 before inflation moved above 4%. And the argument could be made that the gains made in the pair earlier in the year were beginning to expect that such a move may have been taking place with inflation. After Powell's statement to retire the word transitory in November of 2021, again represented here with the red line, the pair did start to trend higher. And this is likely due to markets warming up to the idea of higher rates in the United States. As we started to approach that first rate hike in March of 2022, dollar-yen began to trend aggressively. And this ran through the rate decision, as the bank also highlighted the likelihood of even more rate hikes later in the year. Inflation did continue to increase through this period, which further supported the argument for more rate hikes from the Fed. And what we can see in the blue box is markets quickly pricing in the prospect of higher rates from the Federal Reserve in response to the inflation that was building for more than a year prior. But for the trader that was looking to trade the pair on or around news releases, they may have seen a very unintuitive response across markets. And a key reason in many of these cases is CPI isn't the only factor of importance, as there's something else that market participants are tracking in regards to that inflation. On this chart, we're starting from the red line on the previous chart, when FOMC Chair Jerome Powell had started to talk about removing the word transitory, indicating an openness to possible rate hikes, which the Fed began to forecast in December of that year. The bank performed its first hike of this cycle in March, indicated by the royal blue line, and on top, you'll see 25 BPS, which again simply stands for 25 basis points or 0.25%, aka a quarter point. You'll notice that dollar-yen prices began moving higher after that announcement, and likely a large part of that was the Federal Reserve highlighting their expectation for even more rate hikes. This was done in the Summary of Economic Projections, or the dot plot matrix that the bank releases during quarterly rate decisions at the Fed. Dollar-yen prices trended into the May rate decision, at which point the Fed increased rates by 50 basis points, or 0.5%. But notice how price did not move higher in the immediate aftermath of that rate hike and actually moved lower. This, again, highlights the incredibly important role of expectations and the fact that markets are constantly trying to price in data in anticipation of future economic trends. CPI continued to increase, with CPI moving up to 8.6% for May. This data was released in June, just before the FOMC rate decision. At this point, with inflation continuing to climb even after the Fed had started to lift rates, the bank decided to get even more aggressive, hiking by 75 basis points or 0.75%. And notice how this did help to boost the spot rate after that rate decision. CPI moved higher again in July, setting a fresh high of 9.1%, which the Fed then addressed with another 75 basis point rate hike. The initial move here was lower until support showed up shortly after, leading to another increase in dollar-yen spot rates. The bank went for a third consecutive 75 basis point hike in September, and by then the dollar-yen pair was trading in the 140s, after coming into 2022 trade at the 115 level. Dollar-yen eventually moved up to test the 150 level in mid-October, and despite another 75 basis point rate hike from the Fed, prices had already started to pull back. And again, this highlights the incredibly important role of expectations, as markets had started to look for the Fed to take a slower pace to rate hikes given the fast change that had already been seen that year. This argument was supported by the fact that headline CPI had started to move lower after peaking at 9.1% in July, with 8.5% in August, 8.3% in September, and 8.2% in October. There are some important takeaways from this example that we just looked at. The first one is very important for traders. Data does not always get priced in perfectly right off the bat. it can take time for trends in data to relate to trends in markets. CPI is a driver for markets, but the key factor is how that inflation may impact the central bank, which then sets rate policy. So the conduit for that relationship usually goes through the central bank, and again, this isn't always perfect, because as we saw in our example, the dollar-yen pair was trending higher in the first half of 2021 as inflation was moving higher, but not to the degree that it did when the central bank actually began to mold policy as a response to that inflation. Markets are constantly forward-looking, and the fact that dollar-yen was trending higher in early 2021, even as the Fed said that they thought that inflation was transitory and that they wouldn't need to hike rates, illustrates that fact. But there was another important example. When dollar-yen prices had started to go lower, even as the Fed was continuing to hike in 75 basis point increments. This was due to markets looking on the horizon at future expectations. And as markets began to forecast a softer series of rate hikes from the Fed, as helped by lower levels of inflation growth, the dollar-yen currency pair began to reflect that. Data is lagging by nature. By the time the market receives that data, there are already further developments that have taken place by the time we find out about it. So this further places importance on the value of expectations as markets are constantly forward-looking. A major takeaway here for FX traders is the importance of interest rates in spot prices. As rates go up, which can increase the swap or rollover amount for holding that currency long, so does the incentive for being long in that currency. And if that currency is paired with another currency that isn't seeing the same appreciation on the back of higher rate potential, that can create fundamental divergence that can lead to higher prices in that market. This is what we looked at with the carry trade example. Central banks can bring a large impact to markets as they set rates that then feed into a number of different correlations and relationships. But it's important to remember that central banks are comprised of human beings, and they can make mistakes. This is why there will often be episodes where markets are doing something different than what the central bank has discussed, such as we saw in early 2021 when dollar-yen was trending higher, even as the Fed said that inflation was transitory, in their opinion. The general saying is, don't fight the Fed, but that doesn't mean that the Fed is perfect and without the potential to make policy errors. As noted a few times already on this slide, markets do not necessarily price in data perfectly right when it's released. On a longer-term basis, however, there can be a tendency for those trends in economic data to impact rates, which then impact market prices. As such, many traders that focus on fundamental analysis will default to a trend-following, longer-term type of approach by nature. Another important point, and something that we'll talk about in more detail in a few slides on a different topic, but trading around news releases can be dangerous. This is when new information is being received by the market, and all market participants are operating from a similar spot of opacity. This can lead to lower levels of liquidity, which can then lead to greater potential for volatility, which brings on the dreaded scenario of being right, but still losing. Even if you could predict CPI on a month-to-month basis, that doesn't mean that you can predict the market reaction, as the market reaction is dictated by the collective action of numerous market participants. Data releases can present opportunities for enhanced volatility, and this certainly pertains to inflation data. But employment is also important, especially in the field of fundamental analysis. Let's learn about the other side of what helps to drive economic performance.
While inflation is the primary mandate for many central banks, such as the European Central Bank or the Bank of Japan, it's not the only factor of importance in fundamental analysis. Employment is the lifeblood of an economy, as more jobs and more workers employed are a sign of greater growth potential, which can allow for more disposable income to be deployed in an economy. This can lead to greater growth for corporates and small businesses, as well as larger tax revenues for governments. Let's learn more about this area of the economy and, perhaps more pertinent to FX traders, how this data can lead to moves in the FX market.
We've talked about employment a few times already, and now we're going to extrapolate on some of the ramifications that employment can have on the economy. In many ways, employment or job growth can be illustrative of economic growth, as more workers employed means more disposable income. And if more people have more money to spend, this means more purchasing power in the economy. And this can then be a direct lead-in to greater economic growth. If a company is going to grow and expand, they may need to hire more people to help fuel that growth, and this leads to greater demand for workers. The greater demand for workers shared across the economy then leads to greater competition for those workers. And if companies want to attract talent with this greater competition or greater demand, they will probably have to increase wages. As companies then lift wages to attract talent, these costs will be passed on to the consumer in the form of higher prices, leading to even more inflation. At some point, the central bank may want to step in to ensure that inflation remains at a moderate level that prevents the possibility of higher prices spiraling even higher that may create panic in the economy. This is a positive economic cycle, and it's probably accompanied with attractive growth. Unfortunately, this is not always the case, as there's also the negative scenario. If fewer workers are employed, this means that there's less disposable income in the economy. Less disposable income means less purchasing power, and that could lead to lower levels of economic growth. This would also mean that there's less demand for workers, which leads to even lower competition for those that are in the job market. And that means that there's less incentive for employers to raise wages, bringing on even less inflationary pressure. And if inflation is going down, that could be a highlight of growth concerns, and this may be something that the central bank wants to address. In the realm of employment data in the United States, there are a couple of key reports to keep in mind. NFP, or non-farm payrolls, is a major data point. As the name implies, this is the measure of non-farm payrolls, which indicates the number of non-farm jobs that were added in the previous month. This report comes out every month, usually on the first Friday of the month at 8:30 a.m. Eastern Time. The main allure of this data point is its early nature. It's released just after the recently completed month, and this is often going to be the first look that investors get for economic activity over that period. As such, the data can be messy, meaning it's subject to revisions in later months. NFP will have a tendency to be a significant driver of volatility, especially on a short-term basis. And similar to what we had looked at with CPI, this doesn't always have a logical direct impact on market price action that one might expect. One point of emphasis with NFP is the fact that this report actually includes a few different data points. The number of new jobs is called the headline number, and this is usually what will get the most attention in the headline of articles. But also within this report is the unemployment rate, which is simply the percentage of workers that have looked for a job in the past 6 months that are not yet employed. After 6 months, if someone hasn't looked for a job and hasn't found one, they'll no longer be counted in the unemployment rate, as this speaks to another data point in the report, the labor force participation rate. Average hourly earnings is another big part of the NFP report, as this is a measure of wage gains, which is seen as another factor of inflation. The difference from this and CPI is that CPI is measuring the inflation seen by consumers, whereas average hourly earnings is measuring how much more or less workers have made. If inflation is higher than wage gains, this means that consumers may be losing purchasing power, just as we saw with our example of 100,000 sodas earlier in this presentation. Trading employment data, like inflation data, can be tricky because this is when market participants are factoring in brand new information that may eventually lead to a shift in central bank policy. This can lead to large shifts in volatility in a very short period of time, as market participants are all scrambling to incorporate this new information into the equation. This can be an especially challenging time to try to enter trades, as market makers are often facing the same challenge as retail traders in trying to incorporate this new data. Trading news events during the release can be especially dangerous for this very reason. Market makers, like retail traders, generally want to try to avoid losses, and with a big unknown factor around a data release, we could see that risk-averse behavior showing with wider spreads as market makers look to be more risk-averse with this new factor in the equation. Levels of liquidity can lead to greater potential for volatility, as there is simply less volume in the market to buffer price moves up or down, and lower liquidity can bring on a greater probability of slippage. And with the chaos of price discovery, this opens the door to the dreaded situation of being right, but still losing. And if spreads have widened out, this presents a greater challenge to the short-term trader. For traders that do want to incorporate news into their approach, employing a strategy with fundamental analysis, they'll often try to use the news by going into the release with an eye on long-term trends and support levels that they would want to buy at or resistance levels that they would want to sell at. And then if the news release does bring on price testing one of those levels with some evidence of support or resistance potentially playing out, execution can then be investigated. But the key here is having some semblance of support or resistance to use in order to set up risk management parameters so that if the market does turn that news event into a new trend, the trader doesn't let a short-term trade become a long-term problem that could possibly lead to a catastrophic loss, such as we saw on the first slide of this presentation. On a general basis, less economic growth means less competition for workers. This means less incentive to raise wages, and that means less inflationary pressure. And less inflationary pressure, with inflation coming in below the central bank's target, highlights possible growth concerns. Those can be matched with loose policy designed to spur economic activity, which can then lead to more economic growth, which then brings on more jobs, higher levels of inflation, and eventually higher rates from the central bank. This is the economic cycle and is constantly evolving around us. In our next presentation, we're going to look at how we can incorporate the chart and technical analysis to offer us even more insight into what the market is saying about present tense. Thank you for your time. I hope you have a great rest of the day. And as always, happy trading, ladies and gentlemen.